Okay, don't worry, don't worry. Thank you, Dr. Baru, for inviting me to this event. And I want to place on record my ministry's appreciation to FICCI for all the help that it is extending as an apex body for the work that the government is undertaking through its flagship programs. I respond gladly to these invitations because it provides an opportunity for me to be back with my friend Niranjan Hirnandani, whom I met, I think, when I was just 1 or 2 days old in the job. Mr. Raheja, whom I have also interacted with, and Mr. Gupta, whom I'm perhaps interacting with formally for the first time. But I'm happy to be able to do that because it also provides me an opportunity to clear some of the cobwebs. I've completed 6 months in my present job, and I feel slightly more comfortable in engaging in the nitty-gritty of substance of what is on the table in terms of the discussion. Therefore, you will forgive me if I sound a little harsh in clearing, in trying to attempt to clear some of the cobwebs. Let me take some of the points which have been made before I come to the script I had intended to deliver. One, that we need a cabinet decision in order to undertake development of the many slum or slum-like concentrations either in Delhi or elsewhere. Various figures were provided in terms of the extent of the population of our citizens who live in either Jhugi Jhopri colonies or in slums. I'm not going to do that. But let me point out to you and place on record that in the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, one of the 4 verticals deals with ISSL, in situ slum development. You don't need any cabinet decision. The approval to develop the slums and the authority to do so and the ability to do so in terms of what the government is placing is already there. The second myth I want to shed is that affordable housing has a bit of a problem because the land being costly, land being a state subject, land will be acquired in far-off areas. Nothing could be further from the truth. I think the experience of 1975 has taught us that in the kind of democracy that we cherish and the kind of democracy that we are proud of, you have to develop the slums on an as-is, where-is basis. It is no longer possible to lift people and relocate them 40, 50 kilometers or 200 kilometers away from their habitation and their work. It is equally important, I think, to acknowledge that when urban planning goes wrong, and in India, urban planning has not just gone wrong, there has been criminal neglect of urban planning for 67 years. The distortions that emerge in the urban space are manipulated distortions. And these distortions are manipulated by vested interests. I think you have later in the day a section on the Kathputli colony. This is one of the first challenges I had to deal with when I became a new entrant into the Urban and Housing Affairs Department. I'm very happy to report to you, I can't stay back for that session because I have another engagement, but I'm very happy happy to report to you that after considerable struggle, we've got it sorted out. What we have got sorted out is that the beneficiaries there who were being manipulated by vested interests. Look, philosophically, you can look at this. When you have slum-like conditions, you've got poverty, squalor, it breeds a set of problems of its own. There's concentration, there are people who are letting, subletting, there are all kinds of other social vices, and I don't want to speak about them here. And when we said we would provide accommodation to the people being displaced, suddenly we found that instead of a certain number which was provided, let's say hypothetically 2,800, 4,000 people appeared. Now, even the temporary accommodation which was provided, other people went and occupied it. Now, these are problems we have to grapple with. And then one of the lessons I've learned, which is true in almost every field of activity that I'm involved with, that a democracy has two other defining features. One is the whole concept and practice of victimhood. And the second is populism. So there are any number of people available at any point of time, available to lend their services to this whole growing crescendo of victimhood. So the poor who actually have to benefit get manipulated, and I don't want to go into examples, but you need only to get the first project right. Because these projects essentially suffer from two things: a trust deficit, because those who promise facilities to those who are suffering, and don't underestimate the difficulties of those who are living there. There are real difficulties. But you deliver on that by telling them that you have to take a temporary dislocation, we will build it back for you, and we need to develop models for that. Maybe you can give them a monthly amount by way of rent, in a digressive way, because somebody may just start saying, I'm better off with the rent than the thing. That's what this whole philosophy of subsidy sometimes goes wrong. And you build the project, and the project, as Mr. Raheja is, I think, involved in the Katputli, do it in a record period of time. And then when people come back, the demonstrative effect of having done that, I think, then carries on to the others. I want to come now to the third problem, and this, I think, Sanjay, I'm glad he said, well, the government has taken a lot of measures, but still there are distortions in the market. I would put it around differently. The distortions in the market have been caused by a number of other factors. The distortions in the markets have been caused essentially by the fact that we did not have a regulator in this section for 70 years of our existence. And the absence of a regulator produced a peculiar situation, one of its kind, where unsuspecting buyers, in one of the most brazen acts of misleading by unscrupulous builders and promoters, got them to sign contracts which were one-sided. Then they took the money from these unsuspecting buyers. And again, I'm not giving you an example. I'm giving you my perception. And I may be harsh, and Niranjan's going to get very upset with me later, but I don't think he will. They took the money and they invested it into land banks. Now, in and of itself, that's a risk. But I don't think this was a risk. Because you had the whole industry anchored in the parallel economy, you're familiar with terms like 60, 40, 80, 20. What happened is that anybody who had some earning coming from an activity which was, let's say, parallel, different shades of gray, whenever you got gunny bags of money, you would go to the nearest builder, ye bore rakh lijiye, aur jab aapka agla project hoga, do flat mere naam pe book kar dena. That may still happen. But I think a number of steps that the government took is now in the process of having initiated a rectification. And I've got my prepared notes have given me all those details, and I'll come to those. But the situation is now we've got RERA, but our problems didn't end with it, the inauguration of RERA. Some governments, what they did was, they took RERA and they tweaked its provisions at the point of implementation and said that the ongoing projects would be outside it. So further distortion came in. Therefore, some of the problems you see on the outskirts of Delhi are those kinds of problems. But, you know, I am a great believer in the ultimate resilience of the state and the Indian people. With a combination of the courts, the fact that you have a real estate regulator in tow, the fact that the government took a large number of decisions, I think Mr. Gupta mentioned some of them. Let me try and cover those decisions so that we have a... One is fiscal incentives under Section 81BA of the Income Tax Act, which lead to 100% deduction of profits and gains for affordable housing projects. Inclusion of affordable housing and giving it infrastructure status in the harmonized list of infrastructure. GST Council lowering the effective rate from 12% to 8% after deducting one-third of the amount charged from the house towards cost of land. The 8 PPP models for affordable housing that I unveiled in, I think, Noretco meeting in Mumbai, which Niranjan refers to. The dedicated affordable housing fund in National Housing Bank, which the finance minister announced in his budget speech. A national urban housing fund for ₹60,000 crores set up by my ministry, raising extra budgetary resources, and so on and so forth. Along with, I think, GST demonetization, which people are very upset about, but when you allow the angst of the first two quarters to subside, you all realize how beneficial it will be in the medium to long term. And the bankruptcy code amendment section 29A, and so on and so forth. Now, that was the market. That has nothing to do with affordable housing. The market corrections came through RERA and et cetera, but the market, if it is distorted, will not suddenly correct. I think a lot of people who indulged in unscrupulous practices will see mergers, other forms of listing, some will have to fall by the wayside. But as demand picks up, and I see signs of that, a lot of things happen. Let me give you an example. If you have a big project, let's say an airport coming up somewhere, land values go up. Now, again, if you invested in that, some of the things where you thought your investment was going down picks up. But there's a lot of blood on the floor. And I think the mopping up operation has to be done within the legal system. The old way of keeping it all outside, properties having exchanged hands, nobody knowing where the titles are, etc. I think when you digitize, when you have online building permission for 500 Amrut cities, which I'm hoping to get done, by 31st March, which in a few days' time, a lot of things will change. Let me come back now to affordable housing. First, I think let's dispel the despondency. The facts are the following. We did a study, we meaning an agency in the government, did a study in 2011 to identify the gap in affordable housing. Or in housing, you use the terms interchangeably. It was placed at something like 18 million. Then somebody turned around and said, but we've got so much other surplus stocks available. Anyway, we asked the states to do some validation, states and union territories, and we are ultimately working on a figure of 11 to 12 million. That is the shortage. Now we come to the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana. Very clearly, the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana has set a target that every Indian citizen will have a home which he or she can call their own, which they can own. I'm coming out with a rental policy separately. I mean, I'll come to that in a minute. There are two defining features of the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana. One, that the title will be in the name of the lady of the house or co-jointly, which gives a major fillip to gender empowerment. And secondly, government will not only provide land, but government will also provide incentives, subsidies and credit-linked subsidy schemes. Now, once you look at those aspects, then much of the discussion we've had in the earlier speeches, I think, does not have the perspective which I have. And I'll give you facts and figures. The Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana is not only working, it's roaring. And my problem is there is not to get the traction or get the land. My problem there is completely different. My problem now is to find the money to do that. Let me give you some statistics. The coverage is under three categories: EWS, economically weaker sections, LIG, lower income group, and MIG, middle income group. Now, this typically takes the size of the tenements from 30 square meters onwards to 150 square meters, which is 2,000 square feet. The carpet area of the MIG eligibility for subsidies, interest subsidy under CLSS, was raised 30%, so that you will now get 2,000 square feet apartments in that. As against the 11 million or so that have to be built by 2022, the number of houses which have already been sanctioned for CLSS is well over 4 million. In the month of December, my ministry sanctioned for credit-linked subsidy scheme 584,000 units. In February, on February 8th, they sanctioned another 180,000 or so. The demand for sanction from the states, now the states don't ask for credit-linked subsidy schemes if they're looking for land. They already have the land. They come to us for the credit-linked subsidy scheme and the outright subsidy. Let me just explain to you how it works. Let's say you want to build a unit for economically weaker section. Let's say hypothetically that unit costs, say, 6 lakhs or 7 lakhs. The central government will give a subsidy which ranges between 150,000, 1.5 lakhs to 2.5 lakhs. State government will give an identical amount by way of subsidy. So let's say the total subsidy comes to 3 lakhs or 5 lakhs. You still have a lakh or two. The credit-linked subsidy scheme provides for interest subvention so that whoever the recipient is, the land has been provided by the state, an outright subsidy has been given by the state, and for even the balance amount, the credit-linked subsidy scheme will give you that cushion on the loan which you take from the bank. Now, the very fact that we have sanctioned already over 4 million, and we are sanctioning at the rate of 500,000 every month. I mean, that's a demand. We can't sanction it unless we have the money. And that is why in the budget speech this year, the finance minister announced, and I'll go through that again, that there will be an affordable housing fund established and dedicated affordable housing fund in the National Housing Bank. The fund will facilitate refinancing for private lending institutions for affordable homes. But also, we came up, the ministry, with a National Urban Housing Fund for rupees 60,000 crores. Now, I just want to put it aside. We will, I think, not only get the targeted amount of 11 or 12 million sanctioned, but I need, as I was telling Mr. Hinnandani just now, that this 60,000 crores is not going to be sufficient. The total amount of money, if you use those basic arithmetic ballpark figures that I provided, total amount of money required is 179,000 crores. So please, affordable housing is succeeding. And affordable housing is not only a great win-win for India, for its citizens, for the economy, but it is an opportunity, and that's my message to you, for the private sector. Now, for anybody to, and I am not going into what is happening. I know LIC has raised money. You know, there are groups in Abu Dhabi, etc. People are coming in. All I am doing is to utilize this forum to send a message to you and through you to the others. Look, if this is the basic economics, you can't go wrong on the project. Now, how do you do this? When it comes to in-situ slum development, Mr. Raheja, I don't know how he's going to do Katputli. I'm not totally familiar with it. But if you have land, one thing which goes without saying is that the slums and Jhugi Jhopri clusters are not 200 kilometers away. They use prime land inside the city. Now, if you do in-situ development there, then various permutations and combinations suggest themselves. And those eight combinations which I was which I unveiled in Mumbai, six using government land and two using private land to be bought, in either case, you develop the inhabitation infrastructure for the people there, you maybe leverage the land, you make commercial utilization, etc., and you can build a project. What we need to get out of, I think, are these old stereotypes which we have, that, you know, affordable housing is not going to work. Look at the figures. I mean, I have a problem every time I run into the chief minister of a state or, you know, and I meet them now more often than I meet anybody. The demand is exactly that. For each of these schemes, Swachh Bharat, of course, that's got a Jan Andolan kind of thing, is doing very well. Smart cities, why not, why is my city not included? Well, in an ideal world, in a country which has 7,400 cities, you should not start with 100, you should start with 1,000. But this is not an ideal world. But I think the development of those smart cities will have, I think, a demonstrative effect and a catalytic effect. Now, I want to conclude by saying, at the end of the day, no matter which way you look at it, you had 190 years of association with a colonial power where their interest was to develop those parts of the country which help their extractive industries and for them to take the raw material out and bring finished goods back. That was largely the pattern. 67 years, some of the period we were obsessed with rural development, therefore the urban space didn't get the attention. But in overall terms, there's been criminal neglect. Post May 2014, what is being attempted, no matter which way you look at it, and I'm a student of history and global developments, it is the most ambitious, comprehensive scheme of urban planning and subventions undertaken anywhere in the democratic world. And I choose my words carefully because there is another example of a country which did exceptionally well. It used the housing and infrastructure construction to reach, become an $11 trillion economy. But you know, we have to pay a little extra price because of something we cherish, democracy. And I think that price is worth paying because the market will take care of the rest later. But we have to, no option, and I think it's a win-win. It's already happening. I think the kind of urban renaissance or rejuvenation, but it will require the wholehearted support, not just of the government and its different agencies. I think Mr. Raheja was saying cabinet decision there. Incidentally, two things. I don't think there is any shortage of land in India. Let me explain to you. And there is no shortage of funds. If you come up with a good bankable project, you can raise the money inside the country and you can raise it outside. The why we have gone wrong is different parts of our anatomy and our system have been actively engaged in derailing for, corruption is a mild word. I think what's been happening is truly condemnable. I mean, people settling little scores. But I think there is a change in the atmosphere. And you talked about metro. I've been in this job 6 months. I've already participated in six or seven, I can't count how many metro inaugurations. We inaugurated the Pink Line in Delhi the other day, which takes Delhi, you were talking about 170 kilometers more in Mumbai. Delhi, we have already crossed 250 kilometers, and we are on the way to having the fourth largest a metro system in the world, in Delhi alone. We will have 700 kilometers very shortly. But again, I don't get excited because China adds 600-700 kilometers every year. But we'll get there also. But meanwhile, thank you very much. And I think you I wish you all the best of deliberation. But I want to assure you, these schemes are not only doing well, but the figures speak for themselves. Thank you very much.